And we are live, testing 1, 2, 3. Okay, we should be live. You should hear audio. We should be good. How is everyone doing this evening? It is 2 minutes to midnight on time. Hopefully we have audio. Can everybody hear me? It is September 8th, 2023. The great Vanzini says, ladies and gentlemen, the Tone King. Robert Purdy, hello. Gary Davlin, AQ Music, says we are live and sounds great now. Excellent. Guitar Man 45, Ralph Higgs, Quentin James, Jimmy P, Grandpa Joe, Dwight Bailey. Let's see who was first in the house this evening. I'm going to click on live chat. I'm going to go Dusty Wilson, looks like number one, according to what I'm seeing here. Sasso, Ralph Higgs, and I'm going to scroll to the bottom. Let's see. Rondo Bando. Hello, Rondo Bando. Matt Dummett. So, how's everyone doing today? Did everyone have a nice week? iKilt, hello. James Norton, what's up? What's up? Remember that commercial? What's up? Matt Dummett, hello. So, last week, when I was showing you all some stuff, I had mentioned I picked up a guitar. The condition was not so good. I worked it out with the person I bought it from. They were very nice. They said, oh, just send it back. And then I, you know, tried to figure out, you know, is this a project I wanted to take on or not? And I figured, you know what? It's been a while since I have restored a guitar. I think, I don't know if I told everyone this, but I do work on my own guitars. I've never really done a video. It's been a long time since I did a video about, you know, kind of maintaining a guitar. And I figured, being that I just took on this project, it would be, you know, I would share with you all what's involved in overhauling a guitar. the reason why I didn't want to talk about it last week, I figured, you know what, if we're going to talk about this, let's do it right. So I got some tools, not every tool that I have, because I have a workbench over there. I don't have a camera over there. Maybe I could put a camera over there, and as I'm working on this, maybe I could share the steps or release them as videos, but I think it would be interesting. And I wanted to share all of that with you. And also, hopefully, perhaps you could learn something today. I know guitar repair is intimidating for a lot of people. Once upon a time, it was intimidating for me. You know, at the end of the day, there's really, in fact, I was just talking to Grandpa Joe, who's in the chat, and we were both agreeing that there's really not much you could break, right? And so that's the goal tonight. I'm going to talk a bit about that. That's the goal. Natasha in the house. Hello, Natasha. Ike. You know, I'll give you a quick motorcycle analogy for those that... by the way, a lot of people ride here. Ken Rogers, hello. Ken, by the way, got a gift from Ken Rogers, the on-air. Last week he said, did you check the P.O. box? And I don't. That's why if anyone ever sends me something to the P.O. box, send me a note. And I asked the Tone wife if she wouldn't mind checking it for me. And that was there. And that was Ken. And we were talking about you need an on-air thing. So we're officially on air thanks to Ken Rogers. I appreciate that. Robert Pretty says, I enjoy tinkering with my instrument. I have enough to keep me out of trouble. Yeah. You know, there's something rewarding about... Bullet for Teeth says, long time no see. You know, there's something rewarding about fixing something or doing something yourself. You know, a long time ago, probably 20 years ago when I bought my first house that I was living in, you know, I did what a lot of homeowners do. You go to Home Depot and buy a weed whacker and buy, you know, all this stuff. And I bought everything that was gas. And... you know, a season later, you realize this thing didn't start up like it did last year, you know, and you learn. And that's probably when I started learning things, right? Like hands-on stuff. right? How do you lay down a tile floor? How do you repair a, how do you put in a faucet? How do you fix a carburetor, right? And the more you do it, the better you get at it. And in fact, now, in fact, we were talking about ATVs, and I picked my son Lorenzo up a Yamaha Blaster. It's funny, he has a brand new Recon, but wanted a 27-year-old Blaster. Pretty rough condition, and we did all the work ourselves. I say we to be kind, you know. But he learned a lot. We did it together. That's how you learn, right? You take your kid and you make them do it with you. And we rebuilt my oldest son. We rebuilt. He bought a car, Mini Cooper, 2 summers ago, 3 summers ago. We rebuilt that thing, and that was rewarding. He learned a lot, and now I'm working with Lorenzo. We put new shocks. We put a new carburetor. We did a whole bunch of stuff to it, and you know, he's by me each step of the way, and that's how you learn, you know. And today we're gonna talk about guitar repair. That's gonna be the goal of today's video. Mike himself says, "Hey, working on my guitar today, going from tens to nines. Very cool. I like nine to 42. That's my sweet spot. Always has been. I always like very light strings." Autism Rocks, hello. Guitar Tim, hello. Janice Lala, RRD. Can build a house with my eyes closed, but still learning how to fix my guitars. Actually, want to build a, you know, it's funny. I always wanted to learn how to build a house, and I figured maybe I could build a mini house, almost like a shed, but you know, more like put the foundation down and build the walls and put the siding and a window and a door. I don't know why, but I have interest in that stuff. I want to build things. I want to, you know. And now I may need to, now that we have the Blaster, and I don't know if you all follow me on Instagram, but I need to, now I need a shed. I need a little mini house because of what showed up on Instagram this week. You know, need a little extra room in the garage. Although everything fits in the garage, or as they say in Europe, garage. Or at least in the Netherlands, they say garage. Over here, we say garage. So everything fits, but it's a little tight. A little tight. Bullets for Teeth says, "I still have a P bass and an acoustic that I haven't had time to build yet. Just finding time to do personal projects is hard." Tell me about it. Rob Baker saw the trike. Yeah, so the story with the trike was, I've been told that I repair more guitars than anyone in the nation. Interesting. It's easy, just materials cost too much. No, I get it. Yeah, the story with the trike was it was a pretty boring summer, to be honest with you. There was lack of destination. We were supposed to, my wife and I were actually supposed to go on a mini vacation, but my dad got sick. I think I told everyone a couple of weeks ago. And he's on the mend, by the way. A lot of you had reached out to, you know, just well wishes, and I appreciate that. And he's doing well. Anyway, so we didn't really, the summer was pretty uneventful. And I was telling my wife, I said, I really enjoy going out on the motorcycle, but it's a little boring doing that alone. And believe it or not, when I was in my 20s and when we were dating, I used to take her out on the Sportster. Talk about being fearless, right? I probably weighed 100 pounds less. you know, I was young and dumb, and you know, you just get on the bike and go. Well, I'm not as young as I was, and I don't think I'm as dumb as I was. Maybe I am dumb in different areas, like doing irresponsible things like buying trikes and blasters. But you know, I have more of a conscience now. I want to be safe and all that, like I tell you at the end of every show. So anyway, I was telling my wife, I said, it would be nice to, instead of worrying about the destination, we should focus on the journey. You know, we should get on a bike again. And she was like, I'm not getting on the Road King and certainly not getting on a Sportster. So I was thinking, you know, a trike. Well, we were looking at two things. We were looking at a Can-Am or we were looking at a trike. And truthfully, I'm a Harley guy. Although I feel like the Can-Ams are maybe a little roomier, and I've never ridden one, but I think the design looks pretty sound. But I'm a Harley guy. So we went to look at trikes, and she sat on it, I sat in the front. I'm like, this is pretty cozy, right? You don't have to hold it up, you don't have to lose your balance, you just kind of get up and go. So we slept on it, and we said, F it, let's do something different. We're not getting younger, so let's just enjoy life a little bit. So we got the trike. Thank you, Kubrick lover. Rob Baker says nothing fun about two up on a Sportster at our age. Rob Baker, I still have the Sportster I took my road test on. There's nothing fun about me getting on that Sportster at all. But it's kind of near and dear to me. It's kind of on the list for of things that my kids are going to have to deal with once I depart this planet. But yeah, I'll have that for the long haul. But yeah, it's just not fun. The Road King is a lot of fun. Bullets for Teeth says my pop has a Honda Goldwing trike. Oh, cool! They're really nice and easy to ride. The thing for me, and not to bore you with motorcycle stuff, but normally when you're riding a motorcycle, you lean into your turns. And this, I was like, to turn, you're doing that. Which I got off. I'm like, oh, that's I didn't you haven't used that muscle in a little while. So yeah, it's definitely easier. You're just using different muscles, right? But yeah, picked it up at the dealer and drove it home, and hopefully this weekend actually get out on it a little bit. I'm gonna go see my dad probably tomorrow or Sunday, and then one of the other days I'd like to get out with the wifey and go for a little ride. That's the whole purpose of it. Great Van Zini says that's good to hear. Father Tone King is doing better. Thank you. Yeah, he's on the mend. He's on the mend. He's got a road ahead of him. They did four things: a stent, an angioplasty, a valve replacement, and a pacemaker in a short period of time. All things he needed. So a lot of trauma to his heart, but he seems to be coming along okay. Saw him yesterday, very weak, but better than he was doing before all the surgery. So fingers crossed. Knock on wood. Natasha says guitars, cars, motorcycles, there's some crossover there. My wife asked me, maybe you all know, she said, why does everyone that likes guitars like motorcycles, or like motorcycles like guitars? And you see it, right? Motley Crue, always with the motorcycles. And I was like, that's a good observation, and I don't know the answer. But maybe someone has some insight into that. Alan says pretty serious. It is. It's a lot, very serious. Michael says your dad got a pacemaker also. Yep. Hey, listen. For all you folks out there with moms and dads, I got so many well wishes. I wish each and every one of you the same for your family, whether it be your mother, father, your spouse, your kids. I just hope everybody gets whatever help they need and whatever care they need, and kind of a group bad boy for good health for all of us and our loved ones. Rob Baker says we're all seeking a dopamine rush. Rob Baker, I agree with you. I try to explain to my wife it's therapeutic, right? You get on a motorcycle and your mind, it clears your mind. If you're feeling stressed, you're feeling sad, you're feeling happy, whatever it is, it just kind of level thing levels level things out, levels things out a little bit, clear, because you're just, I don't know. It's therapy. It's very therapeutic. I like getting on a bike. There's something just therapeutic about it. Great Van Zini says, let him know I'm on your second pacemaker and still rocking. Awesome. He told me yesterday something like they last for. Listen, that's the one thing I don't know. In fact, I've been wanting to watch some YouTube videos on how these things work. But last for like 20 years or something crazy like that. Does that sound right, Great Vanzini? Dog PA says dogs, motorcycle, motorcycles, and guitars in that order. Today, just mostly guitars. Yeah, I forgot to add dogs to that list. That's right. Love my dogs, love my bikes, love my motorcycles, my guitars, even bicycles. I have a few. sometimes I think I just haven't grown up. Ike says it levels you out. Yeah, I would say so. And there's something humbling about it. Rob Baker says, for me, I'm forced to focus on the ride. It calms my brain. Totally agree with you. Well said. You know, it's funny. When my son got his motorcycle, he was telling me, I'm nervous getting on. And I'm like, I'm still nervous. Every time I get on the bike, I'm nervous getting on. I said, but that's good, right? You want to be a little nervous. You want to have a little anxiety, right? That's kind of... I almost feel like those are the things that keep you in check. Those are the things that, you know, do you just cross the road without looking? Why do you look? Because you don't want to get hit by a car, right? You know, there are certain things you should feel to make you feel more secure and safer. And being a little nervous is okay, you know. But I agree with you. You're focused on that. And it's good. Natasha says, I have a dirt bike. I ride off-road only. I don't trust drivers on the road. We have a few dirt bikes, too. If anyone lives in the Central Jersey area that has dirt bikes or ATVs, I have a spot. It's in Monroe. I don't know if I've posted any pictures on Instagram, but it's a lot of fun. We have a trailer. We load it up. We go down, spend a few hours, and there's hills and jumps and all sorts of fun things. But Natasha, I agree with you. That's another thing that I worry about today that we didn't have yesterday was people. I see it all the time. I'm sure everyone here has seen it. You pull up to a red light and what does everyone do? They put their head down and start texting. And I'm like, everybody's just focused on those phones. Mike is himself here. Kimber 1911 is therapeutic. Yep. I hear you. I have that same, I do that therapy sometimes as well. Although I don't have a Kimber, I have a couple of other ones, but very cool. Alan's Guitar Channel says, I was thinking about doing the motorcycles. You know, I got to tell you, it's the one thing I regret not doing. I know it's never too late. I tell my son, he's 22, and I see it. He's a better motorcycle rider than I have ever been. And he took the course. You know, they teach you a lot of things that I think are really valuable. You know, there is an art for those that don't ride. There is an art to riding. There is a strategy to riding. There's the way in which you ride and how you brake and how you turn and lean into things. And I never did that. It was 90, maybe 95, 96. Some dude was selling some, you know, tricked out Sportster at a gas station. I was like, oh, that looks nice. And I always wanted a Harley and I bought it. The thing didn't even run. And I got it towed to Lombardi's Harley Davidson in Staten Island, and they put a stator on it. You know, they did some work. $800 later, so now my $5,000 motorcycle is now $5,800. My dad drove me down to Lombardi's on what street was that? Bay Street, I think it was Bay Street. And he was like, "You know how to ride this thing home? I've never ridden a motorcycle in my life." I'm like, "I think I have the general idea." That's how I learned. I had the general idea of how it worked. I knew how to drive a stick shift car. So that was, that's how we learned. let me see some of the comments. I still ride my, is it Harrow? Harrow? MTB, nothing like riding the trails, got calves of steel. Sweet. Rob says, my favorite riding is a bit west of you in Hunterdon County. Almost feels like the country. Hmm. Do you ride with people or solo riding? Still have my 82 RM250. It's much fun. Very cool. So for BMX, I have both pictures on Instagram. I have a GT Pro Performer 24-inch, I think. I think 24. And I have a Monza, Monza, Monza BMX, which I bought. And I love it. My wife always reminds me, she's like, "You have two bicycles that you don't ride. Why don't you sell them?" I'm like, "But I like having it. I ride it sometimes." She's like, "No, you don't." You know what one of my pet peeves are is people telling me to sell things. You know. Why don't you sell? And I get that a lot. Oh, you don't. When I bought the Road King, they were like, "Oh, you're going to sell the Sportster?" It's like, no, I'm not going to sell the Sportster. Rob Baker used to ride with a club. Oh, very cool. Now just select friends. Well, if you ever go on a ride and want to invite me, I'd be happy to join you. I haven't ridden with people in a while, but not to invite myself to your party, but I'd love to go on a ride if it's not too far. In fact, I think I just got. You know, it's weird because we picked up the trike and I got an email today. Welcome to the Harley Owners Group. So I wonder if you buy a new bike, I wonder if they sign you up. I have all this paperwork. I didn't really go through it. But that could be fun. Take the wife out, you know, because there's something nice to when you're riding. I used to do that a lot in my 20s. I used to belong to the Harley Owners Group and something nice about riding with other people. In fact, we have a, this is a bucket list thing for me, you know. We have a Hells Angels chapter in Newark, New Jersey, and they do like group runs, like where you could ride with them. They like charity stuff, right? And I'm like, ooh, like that's for a motorcycle enthusiast. I'm like, I want to ride with them. You know, and they do a lot of community service stuff. They're always posting on Instagram. But I'd like to do that someday too. You know, probably never happened. You know, time is my biggest obstacle. But Cheech says, is it a Harley trike? Yes, it's the Triglide Ultra. Triglide Ultra. You know, RRD, they are pretty expensive. But to be fair, I got a really good deal on that bike. You know, I bought the Road King there. They service the Road King. They service my Sportster. I even know the owner of the business on a first name basis. In fact, when I was looking at a trike, I texted the owner of Harley Davidson of Long Branch. Said I was looking. He said, "I'll hook you up with my guy here. We'll take care of you." And they did. They made me an offer that I couldn't refuse, you know. But they're not cheap. And I was talking to a buddy of mine, and I was saying, you know, you think I should do it? And he gave me good advice. He said, you know what? If you can realize the value in whatever it is that you're buying, then, you know, you map it to value, right? And plus, I know it's kind of like the same thing with a guitar. I never minded buying a guitar because you could always sell that guitar. I could always sell the trike. I could always sell the Road King, right? You know, in fact, that's probably one of the reasons why I didn't want to buy a Can-Am. They look cool. It's probably a better design just from an engineering perspective. But I know I could always sell a Harley, right? So. I do factor those things in. I am incredibly responsible with how and where I spend money because I always, in the back of my head, it's can I sell this? Could I get rid of this if I wanted or needed to? Cheech says exactly. How can you go wrong with a Harley? You can't, in my opinion. It's kind of like a Gibson or a Fender, right? You buy a USA Gibson, USA Fender. You could always sell that thing. There's always somebody that will buy that. Grumpy Mike says for the tone jar, and why not? I came in late, but I got that there's a health issue with your dad. I've got him in my prayers. Dude, thank you so much. Grumpy Mike for the super chat and the kind words that you just wrote. I appreciate that. RD says, can't put a price on memories. Agreed. And plus, we haven't gone on a vacation in a couple of years. So, you know what? My wife and I invested in us a little bit because it's going to be an us thing. You know, when I got the Road King, it was a me thing. And the me thing gets a little lonely and boring sometimes. I don't ride with anyone. In fact, that's why I love that Lorenzo's into the ATVs and dirt bikes. We go down to Monroe, New Jersey, and ride together. It's nice to ride with people. But, you know, when my son goes out on a sports bike, I have a Honda sports bike so we could ride together. I invest in that to spend time with my kids, now my wife. You know, I think that's important stuff. Dog PA says, I just bought a Gibson Custom Shop used, investing more than it costs, replacing everything on it would be worth a new one, but way better. Sweet. Johnny says, HD Rider, a fan broke down, they stop and help. Yep, agreed. It's definitely a community. My wife made me laugh because she's probably got more Harley Davidson shirts and shoes and jackets than I have. And she said, because I bought that for her. That's hers, not mine. She goes, now it's all legitimate. So I said, yeah, you're not a poser anymore. Now you got your own, right? So we got a chuckle out of that. RD says, you're not selfish. Never a thing, in my opinion. Thank you. Cheech says, you're living the life. Good on you, man. Well, you know, Cheech, I appreciate that kind sentiment. And I will tell everybody this. The grass isn't always greener on the other side. So, you know, there's a lot of... Let's just put it like this, right? You always think that whatever it is, the guy's grass, my neighbor's grass is greener than my grass, right? There's always a hook. There's always trade-offs, right? And I guess what I'm trying to say is, everyone here, in fact, everyone should be thankful for what they have, right? Enjoy what you have, love what you have, be thankful for what you have, because there's a lot of people that don't have anything. Like, I think we're very lucky. Listen, I'm assuming most of you are here. Listen, we all like guitars. Guitars aren't cheap, right? But, you know, you look at the world from a macro view. I think we're all very lucky that we could even be here talking about guitars and stuff like that. So anyway, hopefully it's words of wisdom for all of you. Bullets for Teeth, I've done a lot of work to make that Jasmine Sound Cherry. I don't know what that means. Oh, Tim Thomas, I saw the break out there. They had two bikes just in a day. They're always getting new bikes in. They had an anniversary Fat Boy and a Breakout. And I was like, my God, these bikes look so good. It blows my... Like, the Breakout looks like a CVO. It looks like a custom bike. What they're putting out, just stock, looks phenomenal. So congratulations on your Breakout. It's amazing. I just saw it. It was like, if I didn't have my Sportster and I didn't have my Road King. By the way, I didn't spend a lot of money on the Road King. That's an anniversary Road King with a lot of leather, a lot of chrome, a lot of accessories. Spent like nine grand on it. Wasn't expensive for a Harley, right? Just to give you perspective, new Road King's three times that amount, you know. Okay. So, what were you going to show us? Thank you, Ike. Let's get on track. So, let's start with the guitar. So, I apologize. I was talking for 30 minutes about motorcycles and other stuff. So, this was the guitar that I got. It's a USA-made BC Rich snakeskin. And you could see... I mean, you could just tell by the pickups how much wear this guitar had, okay? Some paint chips and indents. You could see those Pretty good. Another chip on the side somewhere. Where is it? Right over here. And you know, the back has a lot of pretty bad condition, okay? And then the neck, which is really in even worse condition. So let me show you what's going on here, which I don't even understand how it got to be so bad. Let me try to capture it in the light here. If you look at like the second fret, the wood is just, let me see, it's not really coming across, at least from how I could see that here. No, I guess that's a little better. There you go. Up. Yeah, if you look at the wood on the second fret, it's just pretty awful condition. The frets are in really bad shape. I actually filed them a little bit and I gave up. I'm like, I'm refretting this thing. But let me give you an example. Well, here, look at the third fret. These things are so flat. There's like no fret left. Actually, look at the second fret. There's like no fret left. The tip of the headstock is all mangled. So I'm gonna restore this, and when I'm done with this guitar, it'll look brand new. So how am I going to do that? Well, I put some links in the description for some of the stuff I'm gonna share with you. It looks warped, it looks worn in like a cowboy player. Yes, and we call that near mint. Yeah, great Vanzini, exactly, right? I have a view here. So I'm going to show you a couple of things. Now, this isn't everything, but the first thing you would want to do is measure the radius of the fretboard. So let me come back over here real quick. If you want to measure the radius, like if you want to re-radius the fretboard, and I have a bunch of different tools here, from plastic to metal to something you could put under your strings to something you could put over your strings, right? Lots of different tools that basically all do the same thing. And when I was measuring this fretboard, and I was trying to pick a fret that was not messed up, I was at like a 20 radius, which I can't believe. But yeah, this is about a 20 radius. And the way you could tell, it's pretty flat. The way you could tell is there's no daylight underneath. Okay? Let me do it over here so you could see. So if you look at that's a 20. So if I, as an example, let's say I put let me give you a big comparison here. Let's say I put a 7.25 and I did that, you could see there's, well, you could clearly see, hold on, let me get it right in the center. You could see that there's light. So something like this, you could tell what your fretboard has. Now, once you determine what your fretboard has and you want to, like, I want to get rid of all these divots, you would remove the frets and you could sand the fretboard. So how do you sand a fretboard and keep the radius? Well, they make things like this. And again, I have links in the description. So this here is an aluminum block. I'm getting a little glare. Oh, there you go. And this is 20 inch, and on the back is 9.5. And you could buy a set of these. They're about 20 bucks each, 25 bucks each. So after you remove the frets, you put sandpaper on here, and you basically sand the fretboard until it's nice and smooth. Well, how do you sand the fretboard? So, let me put that down. the way you would sand the fretboard. And I might do like a little mini video series as I go through each step if everyone thinks that would be interesting. You get some of this stuff. This is like automotive. This is automotive sticky tape, sticky sandpaper, self-adhesive, I guess you would call it. And you could get it from 80 all the way up to like 320, right? Or 420, whatever it is. So this comes in different grits. And you could start with an 80 and just kind of work your way up until you get that thing nice and smooth, okay? And then you could smooth it even further, right? You start low, you work your way up high. But this has a sticky back, it's self-adhesive. You put it on a block like this, and you run it up and down the fretboard until you're happy with how that turns out, okay? Again, everything I'm showing you, most of everything I'm showing you, there's links in the description, but I'm sharing with you how you would do this kind of job, okay? And these here, don't ask me why I keep the boxes to everything that I have, but you could see here, these are not expensive. By the way, I love Stumac. They have good stuff, but they are expensive. And I've done really well with stuff that isn't from Stumac. Some stuff you could only get from Stumac. I'll show you what some of those things are. And some stuff you don't really need. So this is a 9.5 to 20. This is a 7.25 by 15. This is a 12 by 16, okay? And my suggestion is I would get the set. They make them in wood blocks. In fact, you could buy them cheaper at Stumac than on Amazon, the wood blocks, that is. But the wood blocks, if you actually read the reviews and the comments, a lot of people complain that the wood blocks aren't true. The aluminum is machined, so the aluminum, I think, is probably better. And when you're radiusing something, you want it to be like on the money perfect. Okay. Let me read the. If the gauges are shallow, use 220 or 320 to start. Yep. Philadelphia Luther Supply is also good. So as an example. Well, let me get there and I'll show you what tools you do want to get from Stumac, okay? So far I shared with you how you would determine what the radius is of your guitar. And it's funny here. Let me show you this. These are Stumac. These are really old. I've had these for a long time. And I actually used to use these and then I upgraded and, you know, you wind up, I have a lot of tools upgraded to these, but sometimes, especially with low action, these don't work too well. So what's really nice are these, so you could check the radius while the string is on the guitar. I'll show you what that looks like. But you get something like this, let's say, that you could put over your guitar, over the strings, I should say. And they come as a set, so you get all the different radiuses. So if you want to determine what the radius of your guitar is with a set like this, but obviously this is more money than the plastic ones, which is, you know, so. But in all cases, you don't need to spend a lot of money to figure that out. It's a measurement, okay? So radius gauge, radius block, sandpaper, okay? So far, that's what I showed you. Now, something else. What else do I have here? Once you get the fretboard nice, you would get some frets. And what I have here are Jesscar nickel silver fret wire. In fact, this is the same fret wire, same brand. We actually use something a little different on the Badlands guitar, but this is jumbo. And the reason why I would use like a thicker fret wire when you're pulling frets out, sometimes there could be an imperfection. So getting something a little wider will hide any imperfections. But Jesscar nickel silver is really easy to work with. Okay? Now, these are your frets. You need 6 feet for a guitar, but it's not that expensive. I would buy double the amount, so if you make a mistake, you don't have to wait. Like, you could keep going with the project. And they come pre-cut like this. Of course, you could buy bigger rolls. I don't do a lot of stuff. I do very light general maintenance. Then something you want to get. Now, these are not all the same. These are special pliers. And these pliers here, and I have the link in the description. This is a good pliers. A lot of them, it's like you got to pull it open. Okay, this one opens and closes real nice. A lot of these, and you can't see the pictures, there's a divot in the middle, which is no good. You want something nice and smooth. And it's funny because they're all advertised the same way, and then you get it and you realize, why is there a divot there? I don't want a divot there. I want to cut it flush, right? So something like that will allow you to cut the frets nice and flush right up against the fretboard. So you need a pair of pliers like that. Again, link in the description. And to hammer your frets in, you know, yeah, they make these things that you could put in a drill press. Truthfully, you don't really need, if you have the radius and they're kind of semi pre-cut, all you need is a little hammer, and you could just hammer those right in. This one here is like, they're both plastic. This is a little harder. This is a little softer. And it's a fret hammer. In fact, this comes in a kit that has like other things, fret protectors, so you could polish them and all that. But really, you need a hammer if you want to put some frets in. Something I like, this is called a trem block, or anything that has a trem, so you don't create problem. When you're taking the guitar apart, you put this under the trem, so when you're taking things apart, it doesn't slam into the paint. This is basically a piece of plastic. You could also use business cards. Those are free. I'm sure we all have, or some stack of playing cards or something like that. Natasha says, Kiesel does great fretwork. Agreed on jumbo stainless. Pull nails out of trim wood from the back. Nice. You need a lot of this stuff. This is actually just what I was able to grab. I have this in all different sizes. This is just blue painter's tape to paint things off as you go. It's always good to have a lot of this stuff. Here's something else that I like, and I would typically use this. In fact, I think everyone should have one of these. And again, you could, but I don't think this link is on Amazon. But this is an Amazon brand, and it's true. And in fact, you've probably seen me use this, because I keep this right over there. Where's my hand? So you could see it. Over there. And this is good because it goes over the frets, and you could tell if your neck is straight. In fact, anytime I get a guitar, buy a guitar, setting up a guitar, this is the first thing I look at. I put this on the fretboard, and it kind of gives me a general health of, you know, is there too much relief? Is there not enough relief, right? This is a real simple thing that will tell me the health of the neck. Paint sticks from Home Depot, trem stopper. Yeah, paint sticks from Home Depot. Yep, that'll work too. Blue painter's tape over anything you're going to drill in to help protect the finish. Yep. Right, so with a loser, cut the length and cut the tangs back. Yeah, you know, Ike, that's a new thing. Being that I'm restoring this, and this is like an 80s BC Rich, I am not going to cut the tangs off. I'll actually sand them against the body. I want it to look just like it did back then. Restoration, right? But yeah, there's a lot you could do. You could cut the little tangs off, sit it flush, put a little wood filler in, stain it nice, and it will actually be better. I'm not looking to make it better. Just looking to make it as if it was on a shelf in whatever year that was. Okay. Now, here's something where I wouldn't cheap out. I got this at Stumac. This is a fret end finishing file. So when you get to actually finishing the fret ends, This is really nice. This is a Stumac. I think it's actually called a fret end finishing file. And there are cheap ones you can buy. This is what one of the cheaper ones look like. This is by Fret Guru. It's not bad. The trick to this is one side. So you have, it's going to be hard to see, but where my finger is, that's a file. On the other side, that's a file. That is no file, nice and smooth, and that's a file also. So you have a smooth side. So as you're going around the fret, I did a video actually using this many years ago on how to get rid of sharp fret ends, because at the time companies weren't, they were building guitars quicker than, they were allowing the wood to cure, to dry out. And we have this pandemic of wet wood that shrinks, and your frets don't, and that's why you have sharp fret ends. And this has been incredibly valuable file. When you get to finishing files, good stuff is really important. Okay, this is a cheap one. So if I was wanted to do a first pass just to save a little life on something like this, you could do a first pass and then do your finishing with a Stumac file. But having a couple of finishing files are really important, and I like to keep them in a little thing like that. Okay. Now, if you're, this is a straight block, also Fret Guru. Okay. And what's nice about that is you can tell, you could use this, or you could use a fret rocker. I think I have a fret rocker here somewhere. So after you fret it up, if there's any high or low, oh, see, that's a Stumac fret rocker. Okay. And you just basically see if there's any high or low frets. And if there are, or you could do this and kind of eyeball if there's any high or low frets. And what's nice about this is you could put sandpaper on the other side and give it a nice file to level that out. Typically, you put like a Sharpie, lightly, real lightly, gently go over it just to, straighten everything out. And then once the fretboard is, or the frets are nice and straight, you can do something like this, which is a nice crowning file. And that, this will put, so if you take a look at the end of that, you could see that the left and the right is nice and smooth, so you don't damage the fretboard, but inside will kind of put that nice little bevel back on the fret. So something like this is real helpful after you level everything out. Okay. And again, these tools aren't a lot of money if you go nice and slow and take your time. Now, something else I wanted to show you. Now, these are Stumac also. These all kind of do the same thing, so I'll show you a few different versions. After you cut the fret end on the guitar, right? You put the fret in, you hammer it down, you clip them off. You could use something, and I like these files a lot. This is a Stumac file. This is like a really, really nice precision file. And you could gently go along the side of the guitar to make them flat. There is some variance because your hand could move. They make something like this. So if you don't want variance, you could basically put this like such and go back and forth to basically accomplish the same thing. Now, this is not as smooth and precise as the Stumac, but again, I'm going to go through it with a finishing file. But having something like this is nice. And the other side, I actually have two of these. They make this, well, let me show you two things here. Hang on. I'll show you what I do. Okay. So if you get something like this, a lot of times they'll say you could take this. So if you look at it like this, this is to make it nice and flat across the fretboard. But if you want that 45 degree angle, you take this blade out and you put it in here. Truthfully, that's like a pain in the ass to do because you got to unscrew these. It's compression fit. So they're not expensive. So I have two of the same file. One, and I just keep one file flat and the other one at the 45, so I don't have to switch them. Okay, so you could get it nice and straight across the fretboard and you could put the angle on at the 45 degree angle. Or you can get one that has both built in. Some brands have them, so they are, you have your straight, you have your angle. Okay. But these are, these are okay, but again, these aren't finishing files, so I'm not that concerned. For me, let me see something here. Yeah, for me, all the fine tuning will be done with a finishing file. Okay. But having these will help you get the frets just right. And frets take a little bit of time. You just want to, when you have a little bit of time and you could go nice and slow, that's really the trick to getting your frets nice and smooth. There's also, when the frets are all done, they have like fret erasers, so you could use tape, or you could use something like this. They make these little fret guards. So if you wanted to polish the fret, you basically could put that over the fret. I'll show you how that would work. And by the way, let me tell you something. If you ever bought a used guitar, you don't even need to own these to restore a guitar. If you ever bought a used guitar, the frets are always kind of grungy. So with these, I can't get this thing open. Hang on. And I got a bunch of these. Do I have one that's open? No, I think those are. It's funny. Sometimes, like when I bought a hammer, they give you all this other stuff. And over time, you have all this stuff that you never used. But I'll open this since this is all I have here right now. So give me one second. Okay, so I'll give you an example. So let's say, you get this neck, this guitar, and you don't want to tape it off. It's just kind of a pain in the ass. You could take something like that, just holding it over. Let me try to get the glare off of there. Man, I'm getting a lot of glare tonight. I thought I fixed that. You could hold that over like that and then polish the fret and it doesn't affect the fretboard and then just move that over and so on and so forth. And as you get closer to here, you use the smaller thing. So if you don't want to tape the whole thing off, you could get a few of these and just move it along with your job to give that fret a nice smooth polished look. Okay. What else could I show you here? Let me show you a few other things. The headstock. Well, actually, before I get to the headstock, I have a bunch of these. They're all good. I don't have a favorite. Here's a Stumac one. Any of these business card style measurement tools are real valuable. I have probably about 10 of them. And it's funny, I like some for different reasons. Some have better printout than others. The Fret Guru is really nice. But having something where you can measure is really important. You should always have a few of these. Now for the headstock, this is perhaps for the do-it-yourselfer, right? Like when we do Badlands, it's in a paint booth and we're using automotive grade paint. We're not doing it in the backyard, so to speak, with a fan and a filter, right? This is it's actually done in a shop, but for the do-it-yourselfer, this stuff, and I do have a link on Amazon. This is an automotive grade paint. It's a clear gloss, and basically what happens is you have this little cap. Let me see if I could pop this out. You have this little cap, and you put that cap in the bottom like this, and you push it down, and it releases. So it's, think of like an epoxy. It's like a two-part paint, and when you hit the headstock with that, after you kind of clean it up real good as you could get it, you put a couple of coats of this, and then the same thing with sandpaper, almost to like a wet, dry sandpaper, like 2000 grit. That thing will look brand new. But you want something really good to spray clear over. In fact, I was thinking of airbrushing out those little cracks in the finish, taping them off, hitting it with this, and then polishing it down so it blends right in. It's a time-consuming, pain-in-the-ass thing, but again, I could have just returned the guitar and washed my hands of it, but I figured, you know what? I love BC Rich. I think they make great guitars. The guitars they made in the 80s are, you just can't get them anymore, right? The stuff they make today is not the same as what they were making in the 80s. And, project will keep me busy. But really, this is all you'd need to pretty much do anything on any guitar, right? But this stuff, I put the link in the description. This is the Spraymax 2K. Again, this is automotive grade. Probably the best finish that you're going to get on a clear coat. And I think that is it. Oh, and then, of course, you want... let me move this over a little bit. You want a respirator. And they don't cost a lot of money. But you want a respirator that has, you know, kind of... two-stage filter, the charcoal filter and the pre-filter, before you spray anything. Even if you're sanding, it never hurts to put some goggles on and some sort of face mask so you're not breathing that stuff in. That's really important. In fact, I'll show you. Funny, I keep mine in an Amazon bag here because it doesn't have a case of its own. But this is my filter here. And basically you got this thing going on with some straps around the back. Oh, my thing just came out. Oh, my clip just came out. But these don't cost a lot of money. And these pre-filters, you could change them. Right, some extra pre-filters so you could reuse this. And then any sort of safety glasses or goggles. But if you're spraying paint, you definitely want to have something like this. You could buy a 3M for, this isn't even a 3M. But you could buy a 3M for like 20, 30 bucks. They're not expensive. And you figure 20, 30 bucks to be safe. It's kind of like a no-brainer. I want to put this plastic clip on because I don't want to lose it. Let me do this real quick. And then I will check the comments. In fact, this one is almost coming out too. I guess I had the setting on too wide. Let me just pull this out a little bit. There we go. So, you know, it's nothing fancy, but in the back, you just kind of clip it on just like that. Okay. And when you're done, like for me, I just put it in this, just save like an Amazon bag or something. I like this because I don't want to put it in something that has dust. This is plastic, so there's no dust. And then you could keep all your extra filters and all that in the bag also. So. I'm doing this just for me. So it's probably not going to get done anytime soon. But, you know, I did put links in the description, so if you feel like taking on a project to, maybe you bought a used guitar, maybe you don't want to send it back, maybe you love the guitar but want to restore it, I think with everything that I showed you, you're probably 90% of everything that you need. What didn't I show you? Well, I'm going to redo the electronics, right? You need a soldering iron. You need wire. Deox. There's a lot of polish, stuff like that, right? Lots of stuff. I have some wet, dry sandpaper, real high, like 2,000 grit sandpaper in the garage. But, you know, from a topical perspective, everything I showed you is basically what you need. You just may need more, like, of what I showed you. RD says, getting rid of fisheye and orange peel, it's all about sanding, just tedious. Yeah, and it's discouraging, right? Because when you spray clear and it looks good and you start sanding it, it looks like crap until you work your way up in grit and then buff it out, right? So it's the classic, it's going to get worse before it gets better type of thing. And as RRD said, it's really patience. And especially when you're doing this in your free time, it's not like you're in a shop and you're doing this full time and it's, you know, it's a free time project thing, you know. Solar says, I'd probably replace a number of things you're going to fix. Such as what, if you don't mind me asking, Solar? Brian from Oregon said, lots of patience and don't be afraid. Yeah, you know, really, at the end of the day, Brian from Oregon's right. And like I had said earlier, there's really nothing to break, right? Just go, like, let's say you mess up a fret. You put another fret in, right? You just go slow. And it's one thing at a time. If you're sanding the fretboard, just sand the fretboard. That's it. If you're putting the frets in, put the frets in. Cut them, hammer it in, and worry about filing them another day. Dusty says, I've never played in front of anyone for fear of failure. I want to play in front of somebody, but I can't bring myself to do it. Any advice? You know, Dusty, that's a really good question. Someone told me a long time ago, and I believe this, when you prepare, you're confident. When you don't prepare, you're not confident, right? Doesn't matter what you apply that to, whether it's rehearsing the songs to play for someone, whether it's the PowerPoint presentation that you're giving to the board of directors on Monday morning, right? Doesn't matter. Prepare. And when you prepare, and you'll know, you're your own gauge. When you know the song inside and out, you got to do it, right? We were just talking earlier about getting on a motorcycle, right? It clears your mind. Sometimes you're a little nervous when you get on, but you do it. Nike had it right. Just do it. But before you just do it, prepare. If you prepare, I think that will take away a lot of the anxiety of messing up, right? Those that prepare succeed, and those that don't prepare maybe get lucky. But preparing is part of succeeding, in my humble opinion. And sometimes it's about, Grumpy Mike also said, if you're afraid to start, you'll never finish. You have to bear in mind that if people didn't fail, there would be no success. Nobody gets things on the first pass. But those people that are afraid of failure will never have anything when you think about it. You need to fail. Because if you're not failing, you'll never know what success is. Right? And you can prepare, right? That preparation, that diligence of preparing. But listen, we've seen the very best there is. We've seen our favorite rock stars trip on stage, play the wrong note. So you could be the best and fail. And that's okay, because we're people. And people are imperfect things. Pocket change. For the Tone Jar, do you own a bass guitar? If so, what's your favorite? First of all, Pocket Change, thank you for the super chat. I appreciate that. I own quite a few bass guitars. Off the top of my head, I have a Spector NS2000 five-string bass that my wife bought me, I think, the first year we were married. Not being a bass player, I went into Sam Ash in Edison, New Jersey, and I just kind of picked up every bass on the wall, and that was the most comfortable and sounded the best. So I have that. I have an Iron Maiden bass. This is like the Lake Placid Blue with the red mirror pickguard, because I'm a Steve Harris fan. So I have that. And I have a Schecter bass as well. Maybe I have another one laying around somewhere, but those are the three that come to mind. Marsha Murray says, you learn more from failing than passing. Yeah. Solar says, trial and error has always been the best mirroring tool we did years ago. We learn from our mistakes and get better from failing. Oh, you grew up in Edison. Very cool. Yeah, but getting back to, and I'm a strong believer in goals. You need to set a goal for yourself. Let's talk more generically, right? What's something a person could do for themselves? This is what I do for myself. First thing, you have to set a goal. What do you want to do? What do you want to accomplish? What do you want to be when you grow up, right? And then you have to figure out, okay, what do I need to do to get there? So Dusty, if you want to play in front of people, if that is a goal, then write that goal down. And then reverse timeline it. What do you need to do to accomplish that goal? Maybe you say, well, in 3 months, I want to play in front of live people. That's my goal, right? Okay, in order for you to do that, what do you need to do? Well, maybe you need to learn 5 songs. Maybe you need to practice those 5 songs. So then you reverse timeline it. If I need to learn, let me make math easier, 3 songs, because I want to play in front of live people in 3 months, then I have a month to learn each song, right? You see how you kind of reverse timeline that and prepare? So, you know, now you have a month. Now you know every month you're going to learn 3 songs. Okay, well, in month number one, how am I going to tackle this song? What am I going to do? So week one, maybe it's I'll learn all of the rhythm parts. Week two, I'll learn the solo parts. Week three, I'll learn the vocals. Week four, I put it together, right? You need to plan, and there's no hard and fast rules. You need to ask yourself, what do you need to do? But write it down. People that write things down, and I write a lot of things down, by the way, and it could be electronically or it could be on paper. It doesn't matter. I do both. Sometimes if you don't write it down, it's not real. Okay, write it down and commit to it. And when it's written down, let me tell you, you want to have a bad day, write something down and don't do it. And you feel like a failure. You're like, oh crap, I didn't do this thing. When you don't write it down, you conveniently forget about it. Writing things down keeps you accountable. And when you're accountable to yourself, you're that much closer to being successful. Okay, so write it down, reverse timeline it, and break it into small consumable pieces, and you'll do it. But remember, don't be afraid to fail, because if you don't fail, you'll never know what success feels like. That's all I got for you. Hopefully that helps. Anyway, my fellow rockers, hopefully you enjoyed the show tonight. You know, considering all these years I've been doing this, I never really shared much of this stuff. I've done how to fix sharp fret ends, how to install pickups, but I never really, like, for instance, I had a Ed Roman guitar with a broken headstock. I cracked it a little bit more, sanded it down. I not only glued it, but I pinned it in, refinished it. I wound up selling it. Full disclosure, I didn't pull any fast ones. But I said this was a cracked headstock that I fixed. And the person that bought it said, if you didn't tell me, I wouldn't have known. Which made me feel good, by the way. There's a lot of stuff that I've done that I haven't put on YouTube. And maybe with this I will. I think it would be good to share this sort of thing with you. And, you know, it's funny. Even for myself, sometimes I'm like, what am I going to talk about this week? But, you know, this could be fun because it's predictable and we could all see the progress and we could see all the failures along the way. Jeff says, without a plan, there's no attack. With no attack, there's no victory. Love it. What brand strings do you use, TK? You know, I don't really have a favorite brand. It's more about the gauge than it is the brand. I like 9 to 42s, but Fender strings are good. GHS Boomers are good. D'Addario XLs are good. Slinkies are good. I don't really have a favorite brand. PRS strings are good. I can't really, you know, strings to me are like pickups. You either have a good pickup or a bad pickup. There's not really a lot of mediocre pickups. I'm talking construction and quality of the pickup, not the tone of the pickup. For me, strings are kind of like that. If it's a good name brand string in my gauge, I'm typically pretty forgiving with anything else. But sometimes, and you could tell right away, if you have a cheap string, like you buy a guitar, it's like, okay, they put crap on here. You could feel it. But with name brand string, I think the quality is all pretty much where it needs to be. I don't like coated strings. I've played many coated strings, and I prefer non-coated strings. Anyway, my fellow rockers, that's all I have for you tonight. Thank you for the super chats. Thank you for being here. And I hope you all have a great weekend. I hope you all achieve your goals. And I hope you're all safe, but have fun. And get out and do your thing. I like the D'Addario strings also. Yeah, coated are, I don't know. I've played many strings that were coated, but I think I've come to the conclusion that I prefer non-coated strings. So, that's all I got for you. Natasha Nix, you also have a great weekend. RRD, the great Vanzini, thank you so much. James Norton, Michael D., Ralph Higgs, Robert Purdy, thank you for being here. Joe B., Solar Marshall, Ike Stoddard, Michael D., and for everyone else, in case I missed you, we're going to do a group bad boy for all of you. You could have been anywhere doing anything, but you chose to be here tonight, and I thank you for that. I enjoy doing this. I enjoy the participation. I enjoy the conversation, and it wouldn't be what it is without all of you here. Brian from Oregon, Ralph Higgs, Ken Rogers. Thank you again for the on-air, Ken. Hopefully everyone likes that. That was a gift from Ken. Grandpa Joe, Haunted Guitar Man. Love that. Joe B., Dog PA, Barry H., hello. Sasso P., good night. And that's it. So be safe, have fun, rock on, and I will see you all next weekend. Take care. Thanks.